Okay, let me know when you can see my screen. Okay, guys, so what you can see my screen? You can see some OneNote. Okay. So, guys, yesterday we talked about SDFS, right? So, SDFS is a Hadoop distributed file system. So, when we talk about any processing, right? So, we talk about two things. One is storage, and one is how do we need to process that storage data. So in this particular section or in this particular session, I will be covering the storage part in a lot of details, okay? And I will be covering all the interview question, what they're gonna be asking when anybody wants to touch the SDFS, all right? So SDFS obviously is the full form is Hadoop Distributed File System. And by distributed, what we mean here is, let me show you quickly. So when we talk about distributed file system or any distributed computing framework, there is a concept called master and slave architecture, right? In SDFS world or in Hadoop distributed file system, the master is Namenode here, right? One second. So master is Namenode here. This is what we call it master, and the slaves which are reporting to the masters are called data node, right? So in this particular diagram, what you can see that we have one name node and four data nodes, right? So let's say if I want to write any file into SDFS, what I need to do, I need to write some command called, I'll tell you the command later second, but we will write something like Hadoop fs hyphen put source file name and that destination file. So let's say source and destination are the two things, right? So let's say if our source file is something like this, okay, and we need to write this file to SDFS, and let's say the source file is 1 gigs of memory, right? So what ideally will be done, that this source file will be divided into smaller files, so that each of these smaller files will be, you know, stored on some data nodes. So if you see here, we have one source file called input.txt, right? Here in this section. The size of this file is 250 MB. Yesterday I talked about that there are two versions of Hadoop, right? One is called Hadoop 1, in which we are talking about MapReduce 1. And another one is Hadoop 2, in which we talked about MapReduce 2. So obviously the major version, the major difference is YARN and the resource manager. But one more major difference is the default block size in Hadoop 1 is 68 MB. In Hadoop 2, the default block size is 128 MB. And when I talk about block size, by block size, I mean whenever we write data to Hadoop distributed file system, by default, the data will be splitted in 128 MB smaller blocks, like chunks. We can call it chunks, you know, so data chunks. So here we can see in this section that input file is 250 MB of size, and it is divided into two files, 128 MB and 112 MB. And now the question arises, why the data size is different? Because In any file system, it will go through like this. If you have files like 250 MB, the first 128 MB will be go to the one block, and remaining block will come to the another block. So if you see here, 128 MB is the B1, right? And 122 MB, and I did the color coding here. So the green one is the B1, and the yellow one is the B2. Now what has been done? Oh yeah, 64, sorry. Yeah. So ideally all the block size will be multiple of 8. Okay. So yeah, 64 MB. Okay. So B1 and B2. Now, since we have four data nodes, right? So we have data node 1, data node 2, data node 3, and data node 4. So what you guys can see here, that block 1, this block has been gone to this data node, and this data node. Now the question arises, why we need to store the data onto the three data nodes? We could have stored it on one data node, and rest these three data nodes could be saved for another file storage, right? So the question arises, why we need to store data onto the other data nodes? And which factor decide on how many data nodes we need to store this data file? I'm not sure whether you guys know about it. If you guys know, please ping me, I'll read it, and I'll continue my teaching, okay? So do ping me if I ask some questions, you know? So which factor decides on how many data nodes data will be written? Yeah, perfect. So there's one factor called replication factor, right? And by default, the replication factor is 3. So if you see here, by default, the replication factor is 3. That's why each block has been moved to one data node, right? Now the question arises, why do we need to maintain only 3? Why there is no 4 or 5 or 6, right? This is the right question, right? And why the developers of Hadoop came up with the particular number 3? And anybody knows about it? Okay, so the answer to the question is that the 3 is a number, you know, I'll cover the rack awareness later, but the 3 number arrives in a way that all the data nodes are not belonging to the same rack. Like when I talk about, there is one more concept before I cover the replication factor 3, there is one factor called rack awareness. And what rack awareness means, that each data node means each machine will be part of some geographic location or maybe part of some data center. So what you know, the best recommendation is that ideally you should not store the blocks of the file on the same rack. So for example, we have 4 data nodes here, right? So let's say we have 2 racks. This is rack 1, let's say data center 1, and this is rack 2. So in ideal world, what we're gonna be doing, we're gonna be putting B1 here, first copy, and other B1 on the other rack. Am I making sense? So that if this B1 is gone, then we will have racks, the other copy on the other rack, rack 2. This is called rack 1, right? Now the question arises, why do we not to keep this rack, the B2 copy here, on the rack 3? The answer to the question is that to copy data from one location to another is very expensive. And there's a concept called data locality. So by data locality, we means, let's say if client is sitting in Bangalore, or, you know, here's client sitting, and this data center, this particular data center is near to the client. So what ideally Hadoop will be doing, it will transfer data from this rack to the client. And that's what the data locality will come in picture. And that's the only reason, you know, we ideally maintain 3 replication factor into the Hadoop. Okay. So one more thing about SDFS is, I'm not sure whether you guys heard of the commodity hardware. In reality, there's nothing called commodity hardware. You know, so basically these data nodes are at least in production environment, these are at least 1 TB. You know, 16 gigs of RAM, and at least 8 to 16 cores of memory, CPU. But if this data node is gone, we have 2 copies onto other data nodes, the data is not lost. And the only purpose of data replication is to prevent the data loss. Now the question arises, how name node will come to know that the replication factor is 3 or less than 3. Like there's something called fault tolerance. Let's say if we have replication factor is equal to 3, right? So every 30 seconds or whatever, that's called heart rate, every 30 seconds, each data node will send signals to the name node, okay, I have this block, I have this block, I have this block. If for any, we can again set this parameter, let's say for any, for let's say for three consecutive cycles, if any data node does not send his signal to the name node, then name node will come to know that, okay, guys, this data node is gone. Now, the replication factor for block one is less than 3. So now it is not fault tolerant. So now what the next task, what name node will be doing, name node will assign, let me delete this quickly. So name node will assign the task to replicate this block to another block. So let's say this block is gone. So now we can see here that data node two has not any B1. In this case, if this data node one is gone, we will have B1 here. Am I making sense? So what we covered till now is replication factor. First thing, by default, it is 3. Second, we call about something called heartbeat. Ideally, it is, we can change it, but ideally it's 10 seconds. How is the data locality justifying the replication factor, right? So I told you, let me delete again quickly. So, one second. So I told you about rack awareness, right? So rack awareness is directly related with data locality. Let me cover in more details. So we have ideally 4 data nodes, right? So let's say this is rack one, this is rack two, correct? And the replication factor is 3. Let's cover the block B1 again. So in ideal scenario, what best practice is that B1 should be here on the rack one, and 2 copies of B1 should be on the other rack, right? So now replication factor done. Now the data locality thinks how it will come handy, right? So what best practice says that this R1, or where the first copy of the replication is, should be near to the client location. So let's say C1 sits in some location, let's say Bangalore. So ideally this R1 location should be more nearer than R2. Now making sense? And this is where data locality and replication factor will come handy. Okay? Am I clear now? Or do I need to explain it more? Okay, so this is how replication factor and data locality will go hand in hand, you know? And why data locality is important? Because the more local the data is, the most faster the processing is, you know? So till now, everything is clear, right? That how name node will come to know that data node is gone through heartbeat, how name node will be maintaining that, okay, if replication factor is less than 2, less than 3, that is predefined replication factor, then it will come to know, okay, the data or the block is not fault tolerant, right? So it will copy the data again to the new data node if one data node is gone and the heartbeat is not being received for, you know, 2 consecutive cycles, right? Till now everything is clear. So replication factor prevents data node loss. But how do we need to prevent name node loss? So let's say name node is gone, right? How we are preventing the same thing called replication for the name node? So the concept for name node replication or name node high availability is called checkpointing. So let me cover that here. So what ideally name node is doing, see, whenever you're writing file or when you're deleting some file from the Hadoop distributed file system, HDFS, each entry has been updated to the name node metadata. So for example, if you see here, this is, in fact, let me go here quickly. So when you see here, this metadata, right? So what that metadata is, that okay, block one is at DN1, DN2, and DN4. Block two is at data node 2, data node 3, and data node 4. And what list of data nodes is, so DN1 has B1, DN2 has B2, in this kind of thing. So whenever I write something else, let's say I write one more file called F3, which has four more blocks, and the blocks will be written to data node 4, let's say B5 here, then we will have one more entry here that, okay, block 5 is on D4, something like this, right? So in this way, metadata has been maintained onto the name nodes in the memory. And every time, there are two files. Now let me cover the checkpointing thing. So whenever you are making some directory, for example, your user here, you make some directory foo, the name node's memory has been changed to incorporate that change. And that runtime log is called edit log, right? So for example, there are two concepts. One is called edit log and one is called FS image. FS image means file system image. File system image. The file system image means the image of any particular file system at any particular time. So let's say a cricket match is going on between India versus Pakistan, right? And after 40th over, some, you know, rain, it's raining, and the match has been stopped. So when we start the match again, it will be start from 40th over, right? So the scorecard till 40th over is called FS image, right? FS image, and this is stored somewhere very safely. And now let's say match start at 40th over, it went till 45th over, again the raining started. So those five over is called edit log, right? Anything which is not written to the FS image is called edit log. So there are two things, FS image and edit log. Now the question arises, and this question is for everyone who is in this call, why there are two files? Why we can't have only one file, only FS image? Why we need to go for edit log? Any answer about it, guys? So the answer to this question is, why there are two files? Because when we talk about name node, data node, SDFS, we are talking about lot of data files. So it means we have a lot of metadata, you know, like maybe millions of files I'm talking about, thousands of files I'm talking about. So there's thousands of rows in this FS image that, okay, F1 has B1, B2, B3. This is on data one, data node one, data node two, data node three. In this way, there are thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of entries into the FS image. Every time, if we want to read this file, write this file again and again, it will be a very slow operation. And that's why, to prevent this slowness, what these guys decided that, okay, create, let's put that file aside, okay? And every 30 seconds, create a new file, edit log. And in that edit log, for next 30 seconds, do everything, whatever the new operation has been done. And then start a process every 30 seconds and add these two files and create a new FS image. And push this FS image back to the name node and empty the edit log. Got my point? So now the question arises, who is doing it? Because this merging, this thing is called merging, right? This merging is a very memory intensive process, you know, very intensive. To add these two files, empty the edit log, create one FS image, new file. It's a very memory intensive, resource intensive process. So if we assign this process to the name node will be overly burdened, and it may slow the name node, right? So there's a concept called secondary name node. So this process of merging the FS image and edit log is called checkpointing. And the process which the node which do this process is called secondary name node. So now the question arises, is secondary name node really a secondary name node? It means if name node is gone, will secondary name node act as a name node? Yes or no? No. Perfect. And why? Why is it so? Then why we are calling it a secondary name node? The answer is the secondary name node is the worst name which is given into the Hadoop world, you know. Like ideally it's just the checkpoint node. We can call it a checkpoint node. But ideally, in the best case scenarios, what scientists or what the developer, what the researcher said that we should have ideally in ideal world the same configuration what name node is having. We should give the same configuration to the secondary name node, and same configuration means the same amount of memory, same amount of hard disk, same amount of CPU cores and everything. So in worst scenario, if name node is gone, there will not be a hot failover process. Hot means the quick. It means active and passive, right? In ideal world, there will be a downtime of 1 minute, 10 minute, whatever, you know, to bring the second name node to make it as name node. But for that particular time, from when the name node is, second name node is become a name node, that's called downtime. And to prevent that downtime, now the people or the researchers come up with something else. Do you know about that? That concept is called, anybody knows how to prevent single point of failure? Yeah, high availability is good, but how high availability is what is the way to achieve the high availability? Anybody know? Answer it, please. Think about it quickly for 2 minutes.
We introduce a standby name node.
Perfect. Yeah, and how standby name node and second name node are different?
So basically, in the absence of the primary name node, standby name node can act as a primary name node, but the secondary name node cannot act as a name node.
Okay. And what is the magic behind that?
The primary name node and secondary name node share a file where all the edit logs are stored. So whenever the primary name node fails, it takes the shared file resources from that thing and it becomes the primary name node.
Yeah. Somewhat correct. Not 100%. Sorry, come again.
So actually it's like in the first version of Hadoop, the name node for every one, there's a process called checkpointing. So that way, so all the metadata and I mean all the edit logs gets backed up in the second name node.
Okay, so, that makes sense.
Yes, so if name node fails, which we call it as a single point of failure, the name node goes into safe mode. To retrieve back all the metadata or every data in the name node, it takes a lot of time. So it will be a huge loss for the businesses.
Okay, that makes sense.
So to avoid that, we need a name node that can act immediately as a, we need a standby name node, which can immediately act as a primary name node.
Yeah, perfect. No, you are 100% correct, but let me explain it in more detailed way, okay? So you guys are 100% correct, okay? In Hadoop 1, we have a secondary name node, what I was telling you for last 15 minutes, right? In Hadoop 2, there's a concept called high availability, what you guys said. And the question what interviewer asked, the same question what I asked you guys, how do you achieve the high availability? You guys will say, we will go for standby name node, right? Then the next question will be, how standby name node is different from secondary name node? And you guys try to answer it, that standby name node, will be active all the time. It will be, if name node is gone, standby name node will come quickly, right?
Yes. So both active name node and the standby name node will share the same memory.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yes, it's called the shared network file system, I think.
Yeah, SNS. Okay. No, you are going in the right direction. So when let me talk about high availability quickly here for everyone, okay? And I'm not sure who is speaking. It's Ram.
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, you are absolutely correct. But let me quickly cover in 5 minutes, okay? So when we talk about high availability, right? So high availability means if one thing is gone, the data should not be lost. There should be no downtime. But in ideal world, we cannot prevent it. Even AWS, Amazon is not saying 100% availability. They are going for 99999, right? 99.9999. In Hadoop world, downtime is a fact. It will be there for sure, right? But how to minimize the downtime? So in Hadoop 2, what we were discussing last 5 minutes, that there's something called standby name node. So what this standby name node is doing, exactly the same thing what the secondary name node was doing. But the good part is this secondary name node, standby name node, it's an active thing. So when let me write in this way, this is standby, right? ST. And secondary means secondary name node. When we talk about standby name node, is active. But when we talk about secondary name node, it's passive active. So secondary name node will be passive. It will do all the checkpointing, everything. And the real name node will be doing all the metadata maintenance, and client will be connecting to it, right? In standby name node, what is going on? This checkpointing is going through some shared file system, what these guys were talking about. And there is I'm not sure you guys know about Quorum General Manager. So anybody know QJM? QJM. So what is going on in, perfect. So in standby name node, how the checkpointing is taking place, this edit log, this particular edit log is maintained through Quorum General Manager. So what Quorum General Manager says that rather than writing all the edit log to the same location, secondary name node is going on, it is writing to some shared location, and then secondary name node will read from that shared location, and then everything is good. But in worst scenario, if that shared location is gone, then this edit log is gone, right? The data, metadata is gone. To prevent this, the people come up with the concept called Quorum General Manager. So in this thing, rather than you write to the single shared location, you will write something like this. There are three separate machines. I'm just talking three. There can be any number. So there are three separate machines, Q1, Q2, Q3. And this edit log name node will write to Q1. And internally, it will be transferred across Q3. Right? So, and here in between, let me quickly delete it. So here in between, there will be ZooKeeper. I will cover ZooKeeper later. But what ZooKeeper will be doing, let's say, and Ram, I'm answering that question, how that high availability is taking place. So to make the system highly available, we have a concept of ZooKeeper, okay? So what this name node will do, if this is active, let's say this is active at this point of time, the client is connecting to this, it will put a lock here onto the ZooKeeper. That, okay, I'm active, and this other standby name node will every predefined interval, let's say 10 seconds, every 10 seconds or every 5 seconds, it will check for the lock. If this name node is gone, primary name node is gone, then this lock is gone. And this secondary name node will quickly put a lock here. And what this lock means, that now client's request will be automatically propagated to from ZooKeeper to secondary name node. And this is how the high availability achieved using the standby name node. Now coming to the Quorum General Manager, right? So let's say if this machine is gone, if this shared location is gone, we still have two locations. To prevent the loss of the edit log, we are going for the Quorum General Manager. Am I making sense? And now things are pretty clear to you guys. Like how and what and why is going on?
I have a doubt. Like, why can't the secondary name node act like the standby name node? Like, whatever the functionality we are giving to the standby name
node. Yeah, so
we could have done it, given it to the secondary name node, right?
Yeah. No. You are 100% correct. And that's what these people did. Like the same thing what you asked, right? The same question somebody asked at that point in time, and they made secondary name node as standby name node, make it active. It, exactly the same thing. So nothing very fancy. Am I making sense?
Okay.
So the secondary name node is gone.
It becomes a standby when it's
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Everything is same. Like concept has been different because a lot of things, fancy things comes in picture. Zookeeper, Quorum General Manager, standby name node is active, resource intensive. Lot of things, fancy things comes, but secondary name node indirectly becomes standby name node. No, it is nowhere written, but in common sense scenario, yeah, it is the same thing. Okay. So now one question for you guys, right? And the same question somebody can ask you. We achieve fault tolerance in data nodes through replication factor. Right? Yes or no? So how do we achieve fault tolerance in the name node? Using secondary name node, standby name node, Quorum General Manager, what's the right option? Like we have three options: Quorum General Manager, standby node, whatever, standby name node or secondary name node. What's the right option? You can ping me here. Quorum General Manager and standby name node, yeah, both. Okay, and so till now, and any doubt? Obviously, the question what you guys asked are very, very genuine questions. You know, believe me. And I didn't expect this question from this group, yeah, because I was thinking that you guys didn't know anything, and I was just covering from the very basic. Any other question? What is coming into your mind? Anything? You guys can unmute and ask. You know,
I have a quick question here.
Yeah.
The question is, the data is being divided into different blocks in HDFS, right?
Okay.
What is the component that is dividing this data into the blocks? Either maybe three blocks or whatever number of blocks.
Okay. So I won't go into detail as of now, but see, what is Hadoop actually? Hadoop is a software which is written into Java, right? So let's say you, and I'll cover that from the basic, then I'll come to Hadoop. So let's say you have a movie which you want to play into VLC player, right? So what you do, you will just drag and drop that movie to the VLC player. It's up to the VLC player, and you will tell VLC player, okay, play this movie at 1.5x speed, right? Now, what is going on behind the scene, we don't know. There's some Java code, there may be C++ code, but what is going on in Hadoop, that there is a concept called I don't remember it right now, record reader or something. I didn't plan to cover it today. I need to revise my concepts, but there's a concept called record reader and different kind of stuff. So when you say that replication factor is 3 and block size is 128 MB or 64 MB, whatever, then what Hadoop is doing, whenever you are writing this file, Hadoop as a software will read two things. Okay, it will read block size. Okay, from sdfsite.xml, that okay, block size is 128 MB, replication factor is 3. So what I ideally need to do, Hadoop and sdfs, that I need to divide this data, and I will cover that question maybe in this call, or I'll research it and I'll come back to you. I don't remember exactly the program name, like the Java class name, but there's some Java class recorded or maybe something. Okay. So till now, you guys know that, okay, it is divided into some blocks and all, and replication factor, secondary name node, standby name node, different kind of stuff, right? Now the question arises, if somebody needs to read the data, okay? Somebody needs to read the data, what is the read anatomy? So read anatomy is like this figure is like very explanatory, self-explanatory. Here you're sitting, client is sitting, he wants to read a file of input.txt, which is in SDFS, is divided into two blocks, of 128 MB and 112 MB, each block is further replicated into different data nodes. Like for example, green blocks here and here and here. Now, let's say if client wants to read the data, right? And this is where the data locality will come in picture indirectly. Nobody will realize, but data locality will come in picture, right? So let's say client is somewhere here and he wants to read data about inputted TXT. So the data node with data node and rack, which are very closer to the client, the name node will give that information to him. So for example, client wants to read the information about inputted TXT, it will ask, request the metadata of input.txt from name node. Name node will return the metadata about input.txt. What the metadata means, data node and the block replicas details to be sent to the client. So one more important concept which I need to cover here, data, the real data or the physical data won't be flowing through name node ever, not in any condition. Only metadata will flow through it. For example, here, the name node will give the metadata to the data node, sorry, to the client, and then client will use that metadata and read the data from the data nodes directly. Am I making sense? So now let me cover in more detail, because you guys know this concept a bit more, right? Let me deep dive one level more, okay, from here to here. So till now, you guys know that client asks some metadata from the name node gives some metadata to the client, client will read the data from the data nodes, but how exactly it is going on behind the scene. So when we talk about client, client will always be SDFS client. SDFS client can be a web browser or maybe something else, maybe a CMD line, right? So ideally, to read the data, what SDFS client will do, SDFS client will open or send an open request to the distributed system. What this distributed system is, this is HDFS again, right? And this distributed system now send the get block location request to the name node, right? And then get block location data, what name node will be doing? Name node will send that get block location data as FS data input stream. These terms you do not need to remember, right? And then as part of this FS data input stream, what client will be doing, client will use this FS data input stream to read the data node, you know, the data from the data node. But the question arises, what is particular this FS data input stream is? This FS data input stream is that is data file, what I can say, the flow of data files, for example, or the blocks. It will be like this. For example, F1 is divided into B1, B2, and B3, right? And B1 is on D1, D2, and let's say D3. So how it will be doing, it will, this particular program will work like this. Let's say D3 is closer to this client. It will bring at this first, and then maybe B2 and D2 first, in like all the data which is closer to the SDFS client, it will create a pipeline of it, send that pipeline to the client, and then client will read that data. So again, I'm focusing more and more and more again on data locality. So data locality is a very important concept, which will, you know, which the most important concept in big data world. Okay. So till now, any doubt here on the read anatomy?
Is FS data input stream like an object? Like what it is exactly, like it is a file,
yeah, so,
that contains metadata,
yeah, so,
or
okay. So here, if you see here, I put some notes here. So FS data for each block, name node written the address of data nodes, have a copy of that block, like DFS, right? Data written and DFS input stream to the client. So what DFS input stream or FS stream is the object. So I researched it about. So basically, see, for, let's say, Hadoop is written in Java, right? So Java has some primitive data types. It don't understand any modern data type, for example, Parquet or whatever different stuff, you know, what the modern stuff. Behind this, they need to be converted to primitive data types. So what FS data input stream is doing, it is Hadoop concept, right? then it is a wrapper around DFS input stream. So what exactly is going on? It's something like this. So here will be, and these are objects, okay? Input stream like this one, and it will be a wrapper. There will be a wrapper around this of this. So when the request wants to communicate to the internal software that is written in Java, that is internally converted to this object. Am I making sense now? Okay.
Yes.
And the good thing is, so I told you that there's a pipeline of different blocks, V1, V2, V3, V4, and V5, right? So once this, so let's say the client read the block one, how it will came to know that, okay, it need to go to the block two. What inside this request, obviously the for loop kind of situation is going on. For after every block read is complete, what it will go, it will function will call the close request here. So after every block, the read request, the close will go and the next block will be read. Close will go and next request will be read. And at the end of the day, there will be only close, no read request. So in this way, there are 6-7 steps, you know, open, read, close, different kind of stuff. Okay. Now coming, so this is read anatomy. But one of the most important thing, the data locality and the data never flows through name node. Okay. Now coming to the write anatomy. So write anatomy is almost same. What I explained in the read anatomy, but in the write anatomy, we are talking about FS data output stream. In read anatomy, we are talking about FS data input stream. Nobody will ask this question. Nobody asked me ever in my life, but I'm just covering so that you guys will feel more confident, you know. So let's say we want to write a file called input.txt. What you're gonna be doing first, you will be open, like in the read operation, what you open? You open the open request right here. The first request is open here. The first request again is open, and the next request is create. Here, the next request is get block location, right? So what exactly this request is doing here, the create request, that, okay, we are asking name node, please create these blocks, this directory, this, whatever, the data into some location. Now, what name node will be doing here? Name node will be checking this information from its metadata, whether this data, just give me 1 second, guys. Okay. So name node will be checking this information that whether this data is available or not. So if this information is available into its metadata, then there will be an input output exception. And this operation is closed here. Right, but in case this is new file, this is new directory, what it gonna be returning? It gonna be returning that, okay, you can create these files here onto this data node again. Yes, output stream, and then the client will use that FS output stream here, and then it will write packets to the data node. So now the question arises, how the replication factor is taking place? Is client writing to each and every data node? Yes or no? So in the write anatomy of SDFS, will no, right? So the client will only write to one data node, and the replication factor. So for example, let's say we are writing B1 to this block, right? So once client write this data to this data node, what exactly is going on? The replication is going from here to here and from here to here internally. And then this data node will send the confirmation to the client. Am I making sense? So this is again, somebody will ask you how replication factor is taking place internally. Okay. And at the end of the day, once all the blocks B1, B2, B3, Bn is written, the request has been closed here. Okay. So till now, any doubt about read anatomy, SDFS, heartbeat, different kind of stuff like what I told you till now? Any doubt anywhere? Okay, that's good now. So let's cover a few more things today, because I wanted to cover Linux file system as well. So whenever you work with Hadoop, right? Whenever. So there is a, you will be doing most of the things. Believe me, you won't be using UI or user interface ever in your life. If you're lucky enough, you may get once or twice in a month or sometimes in a year, right? Nobody will give you access to that, Ambari or different UI stuff. No one. You will 99.9% of cases working on a Linux terminal. So that's why I want to cover something, some basic stuff about Linux, so that you guys will feel comfortable about Linux, right? So first question, how many people have already worked on Linux have some knowledge? Say quickly yes or no.
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, perfect, right? So see, Linux, in Linux, it's almost like Windows when we talk about the file system, but in Windows, you can create directories anywhere, right? But in Linux, it's a tree structure. So the first parent directory of any Linux system is called root. So, and even you guys see whenever you worked on root, in Linux system, every time it will start somewhere from here. Every time. It may be bin, it may be dev, it may be whatever directory it is, right? I will be covering this directory in 2 minutes, but every time your path will start from somewhere here, every time. And that's where you need to start from root, right? So inside root, there are n number of, in Linux, we call them directories, in Windows, we call them folders. There are n number of directories here, n number of directories, right? So, and nobody will ask this question again, like what are different directory means, but let's quickly cover it, right? So when we talk about bin stands for binary. So all the binaries, such as, like, for example, in Linux, we have different commands. Whenever you write ls, it will list the files. Whenever you write mkdir, it will make some directory. But exactly the code of these commands, right, is written somewhere. And that's where the code is written in bin command, right? The second thing is boot. Boot means booting process. So whenever you are starting a Linux system, from where the binaries of the bootings comes in picture. So from here, right? All the, and dev means devices. So all the devices which are mounted onto the Linux system will be stored here on the locations and all, right? etc means all the extra configuration and packages. Now this is the most important directory. Which you guys in the production will become, you know, this directory won't be accessible to you. This directory won't be accessible to the only directory which you guys will be in touching in production environment in your jobs is home. So in home, you will be like home and then RAM. Every user has a directory at home and then Arno, something like this. So in you will be doing all this stuff. Your files and all will be lying here. Okay. Then when we talk about library. So library files is all the installed packages will be stored in that library and something like this. Okay. So I don't want to cover it, but your main directory is this. And ideally it is preferable. And one more thing is TMP. So all the TMP, like for example, all the, what ideally we do, and this is the question somebody can ask you, where are you keeping the temporary data? So you will keep the temporary data. For example, let's say you have a test file, right? You want to copy just for some time into some Linux system, so you'll push that file here. Okay. So this is all about Linux, you know, the file system. Now, two concepts more I want to talk about. So one is, so let's say if I want to go here. So how I will go? What's the path gonna be? So this and this, right? So it's gonna be like root, this is root. Then I'll go to what? I'll go to cache, right? In this way. So this is the exact path or the absolute path of this cache directory, right? So when we are giving the path starting from the root, it's called absolute path. But let's say I'm already this directory. I'll cover that in practical, but let's say I'm in this directory. I want to go to this directory. I can go in two ways. Either I can write this path, or I can, since I'm in this directory, I can simply write, I'll cover this comments later, but cd cache. So ideally, the Linux will come to know, since you are inside var, you put cache here, it means you are referring to this cache. And this is called relative path. Relative path means the path in reference to some other path. Absolute path means exact path starting from the root. Am I making sense? Yes or no?
Can you repeat a relative path one more?
I'm not sure you guys have the machine ready with you guys, like you guys have some way to practice. One second. I forgot one thing. Okay, so I log in. So see, whenever you log into any Linux box, any machine, you need to enter the user ID and password. So I'm just using root, and my password is whatever. Okay, so let's see. In fact, let me do one thing. I will answer your question in 2 minutes, okay? I will open my notes again. I will go to Linux command. See, in Linux, all the commands have been stored in which directory? Can you tell me quickly? I just covered 2 minutes back. The code for all the commands are stored in which directory?
Root.
The code, yeah, in bin, right? So let me quickly cover this thing here. So let's say in Linux, you can write anything. If you want to see the calendar, you can write calendar here, right? Nobody will ask me, but I'm just telling you the fancy things. If you want to see the calendar for 2020, you can write this thing, right? So whenever I'm passing these parameters, running these commands, what exactly is going on? It is running some code from the binary file, from the binary directory, and it is executing it. It's so quick that you don't even realize, but ideally the code has been executed behind the scene. Okay, so this is what I was trying to teach you here. Now coming to the absolute versus relative path. Okay, so let me show you quickly. So so let's say if you want to see which directory you are currently into, so you will say pwd stands for present working directory. So in Linux, you will always talk about working directory, right? So when we go here, it's present working directory, right? So right now I'm inside root, but let's say if I want to go, how many files are inside root, right? So I'll say cd root. Cd means change directory. Pwd means present working directory. So if I want to change my directory, I want to go into root, I will simply say cd root. But cd is not a directory here. Why? Let me tell you why. So if you see here, whenever you go to any directory, right, there are two kinds of thing. One is files and one is directories. So whenever you will see d here in the beginning, here you can see my screen, right? Or I need to maximize it. Okay, one second. So when you see here the D, then it stands for directory. It's a folder. And when there is no D in the beginning, it's a file. So you cannot go inside the file here, right? So now let me tell you, let me go inside CD HDP. Now let's see. Okay. So now inside SDP, so now let me create one more directory here, mk. So mkdir stands for make directory. So every most of the commands are self-explanatory. Let's say I create one directory called test. Okay, so now to answer the question, what is the difference between relative path and absolute path? I can go to the test in two ways. What are those two ways? Either I can go like this, cd test, right? And I'm inside test now. Let's say if I want to come outside of this test directory, I will say something like this. Cd dot dot means come to the parent directory. Cd dot dot means come to the back directory, not the parent directory. If I want to SDP, I will go cd dot dot. Two dot means previous directory. Two dot means previous directory, right? But now tell me one thing, guys. When I put this command cd test, is it relative path or absolute path? Did I give the full path here? I just did test, right? And it entered to the directory, so it is relative path. But I can go to test in this way: cd sdp. Why it's not coming? Okay, cd. Just one second. ls-lt. Just 1 minute. Cd dot. Okay. So something is wrong. What I did wrong? Anybody? Any guesses? Cd dot. ls-lt. Cd test. Okay, I created. 1 second. Just 1 minute. So I have been here. Just one cd this. Okay, I was in test here. Okay, so let me tell you one more thing. So ideally what is going on now, I have created test directory here, right? So I went to test directory in two ways. I can go to test directory in this way: cd sdp. What's not coming here? 1 second. ls-ltr. I'll cover this once in two ways. What is wrong here? So I was in the root sandbox. Okay, sorry. Okay, so now let me cover this, right? So when I say ls-lt-r, so now it's now let me go to the test directory now. Cd h sdp and then test. I can go from here as well, right? So what I'm doing here, that this means the parent directory. The tilde means the parent directory, the first directory. I can go from here, right? So this is the absolute path what I'm giving, exact path. Am I making sense? And if I click here, I will go to the test. And previously, how I went to the test? I went to test like this. I put only test because I'm already in the SDP directory. So this is called relative path. Relative means in relation to some other directory. Absolute means exact path from the parent folder. Now things are clear. I'm not sure who asked the question. Things are clear now.
Yes, it's clear. Thank you.
Okay, so now let me tell you one more thing. So cd means change directory, right? But cd can be used with multiple commands. For example, if you place cd with two dot, it will go to the previous directory. So the previous directory for test is sdp, so we came to sdp here, right? If I put cd with one dot, it will go to the same directory because sdp is the parent directory. It didn't change. If we cd with minus, it will go to the past directory, SDP only. Making sense? If we cd with tilde, it will go to the home directory. Okay? If we cd with this, it will go to the root directory. So cd means change directory. These signs are obviously, double dot means previous directory, dot means, you know, the home directory, tilde means home directory, slash means root directory. In this way. Now let's say if we want to list the files, how you will be doing it. So let's say LS stands for list. So when we say list here, what it this guy did, that is just list the file. But this file does not make much sense here. So what we're gonna be doing like this: ls hyphen ltr. So what I'm telling this now, okay, list all the files in the reverse of the creation of time. So what it did now, that see, it is in the increasing order of the June, September 23, and then June 9. So it is the increasing order of the creation time, right? Till now, things are clear, right? What ls, cd, cd dot doc, cd tilde, different stuff is doing, right? One more thing I covered is mkdir. And let's say if I want to cd to tilde again, and then cd sdp, and then I want to remove test. Can I remove it? Yes, I can, because there is no directory or any file inside test. So if directory is empty, we can simply use rmdir. If directory has some records into it, we need to use hyphen r, like recursively remove it. Something it won't work, but something like this. Okay. Invalid option, no rm hyphen r. Yeah, so it won't be able to remove it, but it would have if the test exists there. Okay. So if we want to remove anything recursively, we'll go for rm hyphen r. Okay. So these are the things what I was talking about. When we want to go to home, we will be using tilde. Whenever we want to go to root, we will be using forward slash. When we go to current directory, we'll use one dot. When we go to the parent directory, we'll use two dots, right? PWD is present working directory. If you want to know where I'm right now, so I'll just type PWD. I'm on root SDP, right? Change directory means, CD means change directory. If I want to move from one directory to another, change directory. LS directory. Now this is interesting, right? And I'll cover this in a lot of details, because this is interesting. So let's say what cat means. Cat is a short form for concatenate. So when we say cat, and we will write something like this, and we will say control D or something. Yeah. Let me in fact copy from here so that. In fact, I'll start from here, right? So I'll create a file using touch. Touch means just create one file for me. Just touch means create a file for me with empty file. Like I want to create an empty file, just touch it. So when I'll do ls here now, it will be test.txt is here, right? Now, if I want to this test.txt, I can get, and if I want to write something here, and then one second, and then control C. Oh, wait, oh, something went wrong. And then I don't remember, it's control D or what. What is the command for coming out of the cat? Any idea?
Control C, I think.
Okay, so now let me go for. In practical world, I don't use this command. I use VI. Yeah, so yeah, control C only. Okay, so basically what I did here, I touch a file, I created one file called test.txt, then I cat the file, and I open the file in append mode, I added three lines, and I press control C. So what exactly I did, I appended three lines into it. But let's say I want to do something like this, cat test1.txt into test1.txt, into test1.txt. Will it work? And let's create a new file called js.txt. Yeah. So what exactly happened? Now, if I open this file, what should be the content of this file? Quickly tell me. Nothing, right? I'm not sure what's going on. Anyways, so let me quickly cover here. So cat with this file will create a new file in cat covered. Cat file name one. Oh, sorry, my bad actually. So I should have given spaces here rather than this, you know, one, two, and now it will create. One second. So test one, test two, test three. And cat what's not working, any idea? So ideally I'm not sure why it's not working, but when you put file name in a space separated and put a greater than sign, it will append the file into the new file in three. So cat is, nobody use cat, you know, to be honest. Everyone uses vi command, and that's why I'm using here. So when you use vi means visual editor. So when you want to edit something, when you want to do something, you will go something like test.txt, and you can edit whatever. Oh, there's no content here, I'm not sure why. And you will put I. So when you want to edit a file in vi editor, right, you will go into vi mode and you will press I here, and then you will write something. And this is the most easiest way, which I found, because in industry, nobody use cat and all, you know. So you write something, you will press escape, then escape, colon, W.
It actually gave the file name as a YXT, YTX instead of TXT, YXY instead of TXT. That's why it's not open. You gave it as .yxy, right?
Okay,
so VI editor, I think it'll open TXT file name.
Oh, really? No. VI editor can open anything.
Okay. So what is a .yxy file? Is it like...
Okay, let me do something. Just for your sake, right? So cp this file into whatever, let's say, create one more file, okay? YXY, okay? Just for your sake. So ideally, now if I go for HFY, it's there, right? So I'm not sure what was wrong with that, okay? So don't worry about it. I will cover that later. So I just created some stupid file for you, and just to say you. So ideally, in practical world, you will be mostly using VI. And the best part about, and I'm working with VI editor for very long, the best part is working with everywhere. Like, it's so easy to use. It's faster. It's once you know some command, the most easy command is, for example, let me tell you quickly. So when you open the file and you want to insert something, you will press I. It will come into insert mode here, and you will use the cursor. You will go to the end, like normal Word director, Word like MS Word type of thing, and you will press something. You will press escape, and if you want to save it, you will press save my Word and exclamation, enter. It will save it. Now, if we open the file again, you don't want to do anything. Press the escape again. Press the colon. Press Q and this. Okay, I'll write it here. I'm not sure whether how much clear it to you. I'll cover that later. CP means copy command. I used it, right? I just copied test.hx to this file. I just created a new file. If you want to move this file to let's say whatever, you know. Yeah, I will watch the record. Oh yeah, no worries. Even I'm stopping the recording, okay, in some time. So let's see if you want to move this file. Moving means deleting the file from Word directory and create a new file with something, you know. So let's say you want to create test.abc. So what now, if you go here, this hfhfh file will be gone. This is gone and a new file is created. But when you use copy file, use cp command, there are two files created, the parent file and the new file, okay? MKDIR we already covered, RMDIR covered, RM command we covered, touch we covered, locate is not working in this file. But yeah, let me cover find command. Okay, so find command means, let's say if you want to find something like this into current directory, so we will be saying something like file dot into which file we need to say. Find dot hyphen name and find name. Test dot txt. Okay, so let's say if you want to search, let's say it's the same functionality what Windows have. So if you want to search some file into a file directory, you will use name.txt, like find a file. Okay, now most important thing is grep command, and lot of questions will be asked to you in the grep command. Okay, so I have prepared one example for you guys, and maybe it's the last example for today. Okay, I'll go here quickly, and I think it should be somewhere here. Okay, so let's say if I create a new file, right? Sample.txt here. Sorry, once again. In fact, let's say go like this. I don't be using cat command. I go here like this, and I put these things into it. And then I put the root Q exclamation. And let's say if I want to, what is inside this file? We have inside some names, right? If I want to grep, if I want to search some word inside this file, what I'm gonna be using, I will be covering grep in a lot much detail, but this is what it's gonna be doing. It will be, see, the good thing is, I just put melon here, and it search melons in watermelons here, and rock melons. So it will cover everything, every string which is present in its file, and it will return even the line number. Am I making sense? So grep is the most asked command in the interview. Like, they will ask you some question on the grep, okay? Sudo I'll cover in later section, but I will cover these two commands quickly, okay? So df means, what is df? So def means when you want to report the disk space usage, then it will be shown in the percentage of KBs. But let's say if you want this information won't make much sense to you, right? If you want to use it in human readable format, you will go something like this in the MBs. Okay, this is in KBs, this is in MBs. So the disk usage of any particular directory in MBs, you say df-m. Okay. Now the du, just one second, system disk usage. Df gets a report on the system disk usage. If you want to check how much, okay. This is the good question. Even I'm just studying, I'm just making a note for you. Df is the system disk usage. So when you see the directories here somewhere, they are all the system files. Did I create any of these files? No, they are created by system, right? And df is used to see the disk usage for the system files. But if I want to see the files created inside this one, so I created du hyphen h. Okay, so I just created one file. It's 20 kilobyte, right? And the same file what I was creating, right? And this is the information about that file. So df is system information, du is the user information. I will be covering these things later, maybe in next section. So in the next section, I will be covering SDFS commands, because now Unix commands, if you are good with Unix commands, then SDFS commands will be very easy. And I will cover the rest of the sections, okay? In next section.